Well, I've already read for you this morning the text, at least the parallel text of the passage we're looking at. So let me just simply read for you one verse out of Matthew 6. It's verse 33, which gives to us the thrust of what we're looking at, but let's not forget the context of what it is we're not to be doing, but what it is we are to be doing. Jesus says in verse 33, "But seek first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." Do you want to know how your needs are going to be met? This is the way they are to be met, putting the Lord first. Now, as we begin a new year, as I've already told you, I thought it would be helpful for us to review a very basic principle, essential starting point of our Christianity, a very important, very basic, but very important spiritual principle. Again, one that we're all familiar with, but somehow, from day to day, we easily lose sight of it. One that is so important to our Lord that he repeats it many different times and in many different ways throughout his word. It's the way that he's planned to do his work in this world, and at the same time, to build us up, to bless our lives here, and to give us the opportunity to store up treasures in heaven, again, where no thief can steal and where moth and rust can't corrode and corrupt it. It's the reason why the Lord saved us and the result of his having saved us, and that is that we put his kingdom first, that we make his concerns the priority of our lives, that we put his purpose at the center of everything that we do, that we make it the reason behind all of our choices. Now, as I've said, this principle is repeated throughout the Bible in many places and in many different ways. And here's a couple of examples. This is what the Lord calls us to in Matthew 16, verses 24 through 25. I've already made reference to this morning, but let me read it for you. "Then Jesus said to his disciples, 'If anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it.'" Jesus tells us that if we are to follow him, there are certain things that we must be willing to give up, such as putting ourselves and our concerns first, which is what we did before we came to Christ, so that we may put him and his concerns first. And again, remember that when we give up anything for the Lord, we're never the ones that lose, because God promises to reward us. He doesn't call us to do this for nothing. He promises that he will more than make up for anything that we have to give up. He says, whoever loses his life, that is, abandons it, denies himself, crucifies himself, for my sake, will find it. There are people who give up their lives for a variety of causes in the world, some even to death. I mean, look at the suicide bombers, you know, among the Islamic groups. They think, of course, that they're gaining for themselves a reward that they cannot lose, but they have a cause. They've denied themselves. They're willing to die for it. Well, Jesus says it's not enough just to be willing to die for a cause. You need to be willing to die for him, deny yourself for him. And if you do that, if you lose your life, that is, give it up for him, you will find it. Now, this is what he also has in mind when our Lord says through the Apostle Paul in Romans chapter 6, verses 12 through 13. He says, "Therefore, do not let sin reign in your mortal body so that you obey its lusts. And do not go on presenting the members of your body to sin as instruments of unrighteousness, but present yourselves to God as those alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of righteousness to God." You see, he's talking about exactly the same thing here. When we came to Christ, we essentially died. We didn't die physically. We're still standing. We still walk and talk and breathe. But we died to our old way of life. The old us was crucified with the Lord Jesus Christ on the cross. We were laid with him in the tomb, buried. But when he was raised, a new us was raised up with him. We are new creatures. And as new creatures, we are to live a new kind of life. Jesus tells us that we're no longer to be like the people of the world. We're no longer to be, as Paul says in Ephesians chapter 1, walking according to the prince of the power of the air, the God of this world. We're no longer to live as we lived before we came to the Lord Jesus Christ, living for what is here and what is now, for the things that have only to do with this life. The people of this world seek fortune. They seek fame. They seek position. They seek to please themselves. But Jesus says we are no longer to please ourselves, at least not in this way, but rather we are to please him. We have died with him, and so we must die to ourselves. Jesus says in Matthew 6, verse 24, that we cannot serve two masters. We cannot serve God and wealth. We cannot, again, pursue the kingdom of heaven and this world. It has to be one or the other. Jesus says it has to be him. It has to be the kingdom if we would gain our lives. Now, let me just remind you that Jesus is not telling us that we can't have anything in this world. He's not telling us that we shouldn't work to take care of our needs, or that we should refuse every honor or every position that he might in his providence give to us for his purposes, that we can't love and enjoy the people who are close to us, that we can't have any fun. We just need to make sure that we put these things in their proper place, that we do not let them have control of our hearts, and that we don't let them keep us from doing what the Lord calls us to do. Now, Jesus also tells us in our passage not to worry about what this kind of life is actually going to cost us. We will have to give up something of the wealth, of the pleasures that the world has to offer. But what we will gain is far more valuable. Now, you know, as we look through the scriptures, we realize that every single person who has ever followed the Lord Jesus Christ, whether it was in the Old Testament by way of the Messiah who was coming, or in the New Testament, was faced with exactly this same choice. And when faced with it, they always chose the kingdom of heaven over the things of the world. Now, just take Moses, for instance. I think he's, you know, the clear example of one who could have had the world. Basically, he was raised the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He could have been the heir of Egypt. He had everything that the world has to offer, and yet he gave it up in order to suffer. Listen to what the author to the Hebrews writes in Hebrews 11, verses 24 through 26. By faith, Moses, when he had grown up, refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter, choosing rather to endure ill treatment with the people of God than to enjoy the passing pleasures of sin, considering the reproach of Christ greater riches than the treasures of Egypt, for he was looking to the reward. Now notice, Moses had a choice. He could enjoy life now and then suffer for an eternity, or he could suffer now with the people of God and enjoy the blessings of heaven for eternity. And as he considered those two things, he said, I'm going to choose to follow the Lord. So he suffered. He gave up Egypt. As you know, he became a criminal. The Pharaoh hunted him down, wanted to kill him. Wasn't able to do it, though, because the Lord was protecting him. But look at what he gained. He had hardship. He lived a long time, too. He lived to be 120 or so years old and had to suffer a great deal of hardship. His life was not easy, but it was blessed, and it's certainly blessed today because he is with the Lord in heaven. He considered that to be more valuable and more precious. Jesus tells us that if we will put him first, if we will seek him first, if we will make the well-being of his kingdom our priority. He will not only provide what it is that we need here and work everything together for our good here, but He will also richly reward us in heaven for the sacrifices that we make here with rewards that we will get to keep forever. The one who made us and the one who loves us and gave His life to save us also promises to take care of us if we will put Him first. So how do we put Him first? How do we put His kingdom first? Well, I guess it depends kind of where we're at this morning, because it means perhaps two different things to two different groups of people. First of all, how do you put Him and His kingdom first if you do not know Him this morning? Well, Jesus says to you that if you are to seek first His kingdom and His righteousness, that you must first come to Him. And by the way, this would apply, of course, to anyone who doesn't know the Lord. It doesn't matter whether you're professing faith in Jesus or not. What matters is whether or not you really know Him. And you can know Him, or you can know that you know Him, by the fact that you're pursuing the kingdom, that it's first in your heart. If it's not first in your heart, please listen to this. Jesus says you need to stop seeking the things of the world, and you need to begin to seek Him. You need to do this because this is what He calls you to do. Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness. You need to do this because it's the right thing to do. Not to do it is to disobey the Lord and sin. And you need to do it because it is for your well-being. This is how you have life. Now consider for a moment, what good does it do, actually, anyone? What good is it for you to spend your whole life pursuing things that clearly you're not going to be able to keep? You know that whatever it is you have now, whatever it is you may gain from this world, that one day you are going to have to let it all go. Now, I think we all know that's true, but some still think that it would be better to have it than not have it if we all are going to have to lose it someday. Now, that would be true if there was nothing after this life. If at the end of the road there was nothing but nothingness, nothing but, you know, no consciousness, no awareness, nothing, everybody just goes to emptiness, that might be true. But of course, if that were true, then you wouldn't remember whether you had really had it or not, because you would no longer exist, and so it really wouldn't matter that you had it to begin with. But the problem, if that's the way you're thinking, the problem for you is that there is something at the end of the world. There is life after death, there is heaven, and there is hell. God says in His Word in Hebrews 9, verse 27, it is appointed for men to die once, and after this comes the judgment. Paul writes in Romans 14, 11, so then each one of us will give an account of himself to God. You see, what comes at the end of the road is basically judgment day. One day, you and I, all of us, are going to have to stand before the Lord Jesus. And He will examine what it is you have done. Everything you've ever done, every thought you've ever thought, every desire you've ever had, and every word that you've ever spoken. And He will repay you accordingly. Now again, I'm talking about those outside of the Lord who haven't trusted Him. Jesus said to the religious leaders of His day, especially when they were accusing Him of, being in league with Satan, He says in Matthew 12, verse 36, but I tell you that every careless word that people speak, they shall give an accounting for it in the day of judgment. There is a day of reckoning. Now, you might think that if you are judged, if it really is true that there is a judgment at the end of the road, that you've done so many good things, that surely your good works are going to outweigh your bad works, and that God, seeing that your good works tip the scales, that He will receive you into heaven gladly. But the Bible says, God says, you don't have any good works if you're outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. Paul writes in Romans 3:12, "There is none who does good. There is not even one." There was a time when Paul was reflecting back on his own life when he was one of the religious leaders of Israel. He was a Pharisee, the same group of people that Jesus just said that every careless word you've ever spoken is going to be brought in judgment against you. He looked back at his religiosity and he realized that he didn't have any good works. Paul says regarding his life as a Pharisee in Philippians 3, verses 7 through 8, and again, this was a person who was trying to do what God called him to do. He was trying to be good, at least he thought he was, but he really wasn't. But this is what he says. "But whatever things were gained to me," and he thought they were very good things, "those things I have counted as loss for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be loss in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them but rubbish so that I may gain Christ." By the way, that word rubbish is essentially the word for dung. He counted all of his good works, all of his religiosity, his righteousness as a Pharisee to be nothing but a huge mound of manure in the sight of God, in view of the surpassing value of knowing Jesus, who actually did the kind of works that are pleasing to God, the works that Jesus is willing to give if we will simply trust in him. He knew what, that is, Paul knew what Isaiah wrote in Isaiah 64, verse 6 was true. "For all of us have become like one who is unclean, and all our righteous deeds are like a filthy garment. And all of us wither like a leaf, and our iniquities like the wind take us away." This is what is true of everybody who is outside of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, since that's true, since there is a judgment, and since nothing we can do outside of the Lord Jesus Christ is going to be pleasing to God, it does matter what we do with our lives. It does matter whether you spend your lives seeking the world and your own pleasure, or seeking God and what pleases him. Jesus says in Matthew 16, verses 26 through 27, "For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come in the glory of his Father with his angels, and will then repay every man according to his deeds." What does it profit you? Even if you could possess the whole world, you're going to lose it, and you'll lose your soul unless you give up everything to follow Jesus. The Lord says to you, seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. Jesus says, if you come to him this morning, he will wash you from your sins. He will give to you his righteousness, and he will receive you into his family. Again, he says in Isaiah the prophet, chapter 1, verse 18, "Come now and let us reason together, says the Lord. Though your sins are as scarlet, they will be as white as snow. Though they are red like crimson, they will be like wool." Our Lord Jesus says that he will give you everything that you need in order to enter into heaven. When Paul saw that what the Lord, that he was willing to do this for him, he was willing to give up everything that he was seeking before, and he received the Lord Jesus and everything that he had to give instead. Again in Philippians 3, verses 8 and 9, he says, "More than that, I count all things to be loss in view of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I have suffered the loss of all things and count them but rubbish, so that I may gain Christ and may be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own derived from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness which comes through God on the basis of faith." So if you do not know the Lord this morning, this is where you need to begin, Seek first His kingdom and His righteousness by looking to Jesus Christ and trusting Him to save you. And if you will do that, He will save you. And He will make sure that you arrive in heaven. But now what about those of us who have trusted Jesus? You know, Jesus, we have to bear in mind here, the Sermon on the Mount was primarily preached to the disciples. And it's not that it doesn't have reference to the crowds that were all around Him. Jesus knew they were listening too, and He had things to say to them. But this had a reference also to the disciples, to those who already believed, to those who already trusted Him. How are we to deny ourselves? How are we to live as new creatures in the Lord Jesus Christ? How are we to seek first His kingdom and His righteousness? Well, let me give you just a few principles. I mean, the Bible was written to answer that very question. First of all, we need to make sure that in the choices we make, that we always choose the things that the Lord tells us are the right choices, that are the good choices. We need to make sure that we live according to His Word, according to this blueprint He has given us for our lives. And I think you'll agree with me, if you read the Bible, the Lord spells out in great detail what it is He wants us to do, how He wants us to conduct ourselves in this world for His glory. Paul writes to Timothy in 2 Timothy 3:16 through 17, "All Scripture, that is, the Bible, is inspired by God, that is breathed out by God, and is profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, for training in righteousness, so that the man of God, the woman of God, the child of God may be adequate, equipped for every good work." I want you to notice that Paul says here, all Scripture. And when he wrote this, all Scripture meant primarily the Old Testament. God has given us an Old Testament and a New Testament. He's given us a whole Bible. The whole Bible is God-breathed. The whole Bible is profitable, and it will help us put first His kingdom and seek His righteousness. We have to follow His Word. Whenever we turn from His plan, whenever we turn away from what the Word of God says and we do what we want to do instead of what God wants us to do, we're doing exactly what we did when we were outside of Jesus Christ, when we were putting ourselves first. We're setting our minds on our own interests rather than His interests. We are not doing what Jesus would do. Remember, Jesus is the one who sets for us the example. He says, "Follow me," and He means by that not just when He said that to disciples, "Trail behind me," or, you know, what He was saying was, "Follow me, and I'm going to teach you to become like me. I'm going to give you my Spirit so that you will be able to come like me." And what was Jesus like? He didn't live for Himself. He lived for His Father. He put the kingdom first and His righteousness first, and He pursued that His entire life. To do the opposite of that is to live a selfish, self-centered life, doing what we want to do instead of what He wants us to do. That's not what Jesus did. Paul writes in Philippians 2, verses 3 through 5, "Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others." Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. And then Paul goes on to tell us how Jesus humbled Himself. He took on Himself the likeness of sinful flesh, humbled Himself even to the point of becoming a curse on the cross. He died for our sins. He was buried in the tomb, considered to be rejected by God, but then rose again from the dead, and God highly exalted Him because He was willing to humble Himself and put the kingdom of God and His righteousness first. Jesus always did that, and that's what He calls us to do. So first of all, we need to do what the Lord calls us to do. Now secondly, when we have a choice between several things that may be good in themselves, I think the Lord would have us to choose what would bring the most honor, to the Lord. Now, Paul reminded Titus that Jesus, in Titus 2:14, gave himself for us to redeem us from every lawless deed and to purify for himself a people for his own possession, zealous for good deeds. The Lord wants us to put the kingdom first, and he tells us how to do that in the Word of God, and so we know what we're supposed to do, but sometimes we have a choice between different things that are good. So the question is, what do we do? Which one do I choose? Well, I think the wise choice would be that choice which gives maximum profit to the Lord, that makes the best use of his talents. Because when we do that, not only do we profit the Lord, but we also profit ourselves. You know, John Calvin is somebody that we should be familiar with in church history. I think you know, if you know anything about his past, that he didn't want to do what it is that he did, I mean, in a certain sense. When Calvin first went through Geneva, he was on his way to Strasbourg. He wanted to be a scholar, live a quiet and peaceful life. That's what his plan was. That's what he would have done if he had carried out his plan. But when William Farrell saw that Calvin, and he knew Calvin already because Calvin had already written the Institutes, it was a smaller work at that time, but he said, here is a man who can help the cause of the Reformation in Geneva. So William Farrell says to Calvin, I think you should stay here and that you should work here. And Calvin didn't want to, so Farrell looked at him and he says, if you go to Strasbourg, may God condemn your work. And Calvin was frightened, and he heard the voice of God through Farrell. And so Calvin gave up the life, the quiet life of a scholar. He stayed in Geneva. He suffered a great deal of difficulty in doing that. But God moved the Reformation forward. God blessed his work. Essentially, the rest is history. John Wesley, as you know, who was the leader of Wesley, or the founder of Methodism, Wesleyan Methodism, once said to his fellow workers, you have nothing to do but to save souls. Therefore, spend and be spent in this work. And go not only to those that need you, but to those that need you most. It is not your business to preach so many times and to take care of this or that society, but to save as many souls as you can, to bring as many sinners as you possibly can to repentance. You know, that is really what our Lord Jesus Christ tells us to do. But I want you to notice, he says, don't just go where you might be useful, but go where you might be most useful, particularly in the salvation of souls. The Lord wants us to do the best we can with the time and the gifts and the opportunities that he has given us. He wants us to be as useful as we can. And then thirdly, we should choose what is most honoring to him, even if it means that we must face the greatest hardship. Let me just remind you what we saw in the case of Moses. Moses could have had a very plush and comfortable life in Egypt, but he gave it all up in order to suffer with God's people. Look at Paul's life. Was his life an easy life? No, it was a laborious life. It was a life of great suffering and persecution. In 2 Corinthians 11:23 through 33, I'm not going to read that, he gives a catalog of everything that he had to endure in order to serve his Lord. What about the rest of the disciples? They were often absent from their homes. They had to go without the comfort of their loved ones. It was a hard road, even while they were with Jesus, and particularly after Jesus was taken and rose again, and Jesus sent them. John Calvin, I already mentioned, had to suffer a great deal when he answered God's call to become the leader of the Reformation. Serving the Lord is never easy. You know, we just went through the October series, remember, of the Reformation series, and we saw five examples of men who put the kingdom first and God's righteousness first and labored as much as they could to do as much good as they could, and we also saw how they had to suffer. John Knox was essentially an outlaw. John Bunyan spent years in a jail. John Newton, you know, we don't know about specific things about his life, of the difficulties. He almost seems to have lived a charmed life in comparison to the others, but we know he also experienced difficulties. Charles Spurgeon, his labors and the pressure that was put upon him and the persecution from the church as well as the people who didn't know the Lord took their toll on him, and he basically died in his 50s, as did George Whitefield. And I think Jonathan Edwards would have lived longer if he just hadn't taken that smallpox inoculation. Eric Little, you know, he was a missionary in China, and he wanted to stay there and minister to the people as long as he could, and he had to suffer. He was in an internment camp for quite some time, and he died there. But you see, this is the price that we must be willing to pay if we would seek first his kingdom and his righteousness. Let's not forget that none of these men that we've just considered, and there are many women as well, would have gone any other way. Putting the kingdom first is difficult, but it is the path where the Lord gives his greatest blessings. The Lord may demand a great deal from us, but he blesses much more. And so it is worth it. Now, he blesses in this life, but he also blesses in the life to come. It is worth whatever price we must pay. So may the Lord then encourage each of us this morning to put his kingdom first, to choose what we know is honoring to him, to choose what we know honors him the most, and to make that choice, no matter how difficult it may be or how much we must deny ourselves. That's what our Lord did in his own life, to bring us to himself. And he says to us, follow my example, follow me, pick up your cross, deny yourself, and follow after me. May the Lord give us grace, the grace we need to follow that example. Let's bow for a moment of prayer. Let's ask the Lord to take his word and drive it into our hearts.